So again, hi, my name is Razvan. I'm from Wyliodrin, which is an open source tool for IoT development. This is a preview of the project. That's how our product looks like. I'll talk about the features later. First, before we talk about the software solution, we talk about the hardware. Before the Raspberry Pi appeared, there were very few embedded devices and very expensive. Why is that? Because the documentation was sparse. The people didn't know what microcontroller to take. Let's take an example of a 15-year-old boy who wants to program a board, a microcontroller. He goes to the store, he don't know what to buy, and then it doesn't, when he searches on the internet for the documentation, he doesn't find anything for anything helpful. And so Raspberry Pi changed the game. As you can see in this picture, in 2016, the number of connected devices reaches 6.5 billion devices, 6.5 IoT devices. IoT device is a general term. You can call an IoT device any simple device that isn't connected to the internet. Like, for example, a t-shirt or a shoe or a pair of shoes that putting a microcontroller on it or some sensors, we can transform it into an IoT device by connecting it to the internet. What is our vision? We want to make this as simple as possible, taking the board, connecting it to the internet, and then running examples on it. We want to make a new approach towards engineering. Again, the 15-year-old boy example. We want that boy to go to the store, to know what to buy, to know how to connect the board, and to run their examples flawless. We want to make, in less words, IoT accessible to everyone. This is the IoT stack. It has four layers, from the bottom to the top. The first layer is the sensors. The sensors are small devices that gather data from our environment. Only that, only gathering data. No processing, no storage, no nothing. Next, on the layer two, there is the edge computing part. Small microcontrollers or boards that take data from these sensors and then process it very minimally, just small, minimal processing or storage of the data. Next, we have the communication part. Think for an example of a board with Ethernet or wireless connectivity, like the Raspberry. This board can connect to the internet, getting the data from the sensors, and then parsing it to a higher level server, let's say the Google server, that uses your searches on the internet to suggest you what would you want to search. This is the full IoT stack. What's the problem? The Arduino, we take an example of the Arduino Uno. Does very well on the first two levels. It has a part on it on which we can process and storage some data, store some data, but also you can connect sensors very easily on it. Just put a sensor there and it works. For the layer 2 and 3, it doesn't have connectivity to the Ethernet, to the internet through an Ethernet port. There are shields you can connect to the Arduino, but still it doesn't work out of the box. Raspberry Pi, on the other hand, follows the full stack, the layer 2, 3, and 4. It has some processing power in it. You can process all the inputs you take from it, but then you can also, on the networking part, send it through wireless. Raspberry Pi has wireless, and send it to a big server to do analytics on statistics on the data. But sensors are kind of hard to connect to the Raspberry. So there are two parts, microcontrollers like the Arduino Uno and the embedded boards like the Raspberry. The guys at the Arduino haven't had a new solution called Arduino Uno. It has the best of both worlds, both a microcontroller part and an embedded board, two processors linked using a so-called bridge or linear IO. This board, going back to the stack, follows all the four steps in the stack, all the four layers. You can connect easily sensor on it. It has a part on it, in it on which we can do calculations, processing, and storage area. You can talk to the internet by using the Ethernet port or using a wireless, the wireless embedded on it, and you can, this information can go to the servers to analyze and process the data to make statistics. Another problem that we found, that there are no development tools available for all the boards together. You want to make, let's say, a program for Raspberry, for Udoneo, for Arduino, Raspberry, Udoneo, and for Intel. You have to make four programs for each of these boards, one for each, and then you have to make different, to have different, different compiling, different environments available for these programs to run. So we wanted to make this into a collection of one whole solution, one script to run on every board. And we wanted to make this accessible. Like, again, with a 15-year-old boy. He goes to the store, he buys the microcontroller or the embedded board. After connecting the embedded board, he just needs to run one script. It doesn't matter what board, what manufacturer the board is from. So the solution is to transfer the accessibility typical from the Arduino to the Raspberry Pi. There are some functions that run on pins, the basic input and output of the pins. The digital write, analog write, digital read, and analog read. This is the basis input and output of general purpose input-output pins. We want to make this to run on a whole range of microcontroller of board or embedded boards. Let's say we want to make this run on a Raspberry, on a Udoneo. So in the first, our solution is very easy to use. You make one script with minimal to no modification. You can run this on an Arduino, on a Raspberry, on a Udoneo, or an Intel. Also, you have direct access to the board. You have direct access to all its capabilities, to the wireless, to the pins available, and so on. Also, because the, let's say, again, the 15-year-old kid who takes the board and connects it, he has a high productivity. He just connects the board with no minimal connection issues. It can run any script that's in our example library with no hassle. And you can use it from anywhere. You can have the board here and go over the ocean and run the script there. This is our solution. It's called Wyliodrin. It's a fully web-based IDE. It has open source components. It has accounts, free for basic use, and there are some premium accounts that have extra features. It supports a lot of of embedded boards, starting from Arduino Uno, Raspberry, the Intel board, Udoneo, and BeagleBoneBack, and many more. This is a wave-based solution. So, as I said, you can go over the ocean, you can connect the boards here, let's say an Arduino Uno and a Raspberry Pi, you can make them talk one to each other, and also, let's say you have a Raspberry Pi controlled robot, you can take your phone, you connect the phone to the Wyliodrin using this dedicated app, and then using the phone's gyroscope and accelerometer sensors, you can make the robot walk and do whatever you want to do. Wyliodrin Studio is the open source solution, a fully open source solution. It's available for this board, and it works locally. It is the community requested that an open source solution would be very awesome for using educational and industrial for industrial and education purposes. This is how Arduino, how Wyliodrin Studio works. It has a big code area where you can write your code in your preferred scripting language, Python or JavaScript. We'll talk about this later. We have a console, a task manager, a file manager. First, how do boards connect to it? There are two main ways. Let's say that the board supports serial. You can connect with a serial cable from the board directly to the computer and then run the examples, or you can use an IP address, a remote connection. These devices are Internet of Things, so if we go to, let's say again, over the ocean and put a device over there, being an IoT device, it means that it can take an IP, it takes an IP address, and using, and you can connect it directly. If the device is in our network, Using multicast DNS, we can discover the devices and connect to it more, more easily. For the programming part, we have a professional code editor. You can run scripts in Python or JavaScript languages, and it has some feature, advanced features such as code highlighting and autocomplete. Also, we have for for advanced users the stream language, which is an implementation of Node-RED. You take some nodes, you link them together, and then after running the program, the board does what you put does what it's expected to do. In this implementation of Node-RED, we made some nodes by ourselves. Some nodes that will make connecting to the Raspberry Pi spin or to the Arduino spin much more easily. Also, you have the visual programming part. This is for the beginner users. Users can drag and drop blocks of code. Let's say this is a while block, and here you can say what should it do while it's running the while code. Also, for the beginner to learn, after they take the board from the store and connect it and run this example, they can see how what code their blockly implementation created. So let's say we made a while loop with making a pin high and low, and they can see in the Python language how this applies to their solution. And so they can change the code to be suitable for their application. Also, we have a dashboard section. Here, various sensors that we gather. Like this is a temperature sensor, for example. We put labels on them, and we read them from the board. And it's nicely displayed in a graph here, in a plot. For the users that want to make a complete solution, we have the options to import schemas from Fritzing. Like, for example, I want to make an automatic door for my house. I make the program, anything in Python, in JavaScript, in Blockly, and then I make this schema. Let's say we need the proximity sensor, we need a LED to know if our door is open or closed, and so on. And all this can be bundled into one project that can be given on the internet for others to try to see and try. For the more advanced users, we have a shell that can run Linux commands. In these pictures, you can see Midnight Commander is a file explorer for Linux. And you also have a board manager. Here they are all connected boards that that are available on this that are available to our program. You can see there is an Arduino Uno first that our through multicast DNS we found its IP address. A Raspberry Pi are the same. We also can connect to the serial port, as I said before, and if we don't know the device is not in our network, it's in another network, we can use the IP address method. We type the IP, and we can connect to any board anywhere in the world. Also, we have some, after the board is connected, we can check the libraries. The libraries are, for Python and for JavaScript, small pieces of code that is our interaction with it. Let's say a Bluetooth library for JavaScript. Just import the Bluetooth module and just send and receive data. We also made the file explorer tab on which you can see the board's internal files and folders. And you can see the network connections also on the board. If, let's say, this Arduino Uno has also an Ethernet and the wireless connectivity to the network, you can see both of them. You can change the wireless connectivity. You can make it connect to a specific network, and so on. Libwyliodrin is what you use to make all this possible. It's an open source library. It has a universal API for pin control and board communication. As I said before, the four main functions to read and write for the pins. We want to make them available all over the embedded boards of our manufacturers. Until now, it's compatible with these boards, the Arduino Uno, of course, Raspberry Pi, the Intel boards, the BeagleBone, and the Edo Neo. What we want to make in the to do in the future? We'd like to enlarge the community. We want to make all people, from high school pupils to students, teachers, hobbyists, even enthusiasts, to use our solution, to try to learn, to make their solution on our software, because it's much easier to do to configure a IoT problem, IoT solution with a minimal hassle. Also, we have a YouTube channel on which we put lessons. We try to update the channel. We have a YouTube channel on which we put put lessons, and we try to for the beginner users to make them see and learn how to do simple IoT stuff, like turning a LED on and off, to make a speaker for their house, or so on. We also write books about Wyliodrin Studio, and in the books, there are several examples available to teach the beginner software enthusiast to reach its full potential. Also, because some of the users don't have available a board to try, we want to make the hardware simulation embedded into our program. So let's take the again the 15-year-old boy. He can't take a board until, let's say, 2 weeks, because that's the shipping time. He can try to download Wyliodrin Studio, connect it board to it. Run Wyliodrin Studio, check one of the examples, and run it on the simulated hardware. Let's say a LED will blink. The LED will blink, and then when the board arrives, he can do the same, but now with real equipment, and they'll see that it works like in our emulator. And also, we like to for the community to share projects. Like I said before, a guy who makes a sensor for the door, he will pack it alongside with its schema and send it on the internet. This is open source. A lot of people will collaborate to make the solution as best as possible. So the guy puts his project on the internet, people make additions to it, and as a result, you can have the best IoT solution as possible. Thank you. Any questions? I'll make after the questions, if you have any, I'll make a demo with the Arduino Uno. Any questions? No? Okay. So here you have an Arduino Uno. It's connected through the internet, Ethernet to our computer. And this is Wyliodrin Studio. This is the code that I write just before the presentation. It's a simple blinking. This shouldn't be there. Okay. It's a simple input thing. You have a button on the breadboard. When we press the button, we'll see low. When you press when you unpress the button, you see low. When you press the button, you see high. I'll just connect the breadboard to the Arduino Uno. We must connect the board. Like I said before, there are, as you can see, being connected to the wireless gives us a lot, all the boards connected. There is an AirPi music somewhere in this building connected to the wireless that we can connect to it and access its functionalities. And this is our Arduino. We connect to it. Just a second, sorry. So we connect to the Arduino Uno. Just a second. And we have all the capabilities of the board. First, we have the network part, on which we can see that on the wireless is connected to our wireless, to the wireless in this room. We have the Ethernet connection. Like I said, it's also connected through the Ethernet cable to my computer. We have the task manager, the package manager, and also a file explorer. This solution is to easily see on a board that may be here or maybe again over the ocean, to easily see their packages, to not fumble with SSH and list all the content directories and so. And this is the code. I run the code. And then, as the code says, it will try to read from the pin 13. If it sees the button is unpressed, it is low. And then you press the button, it writes high, low, and high. also, you can have projects that, just a second, uses the Arduino's pin 13. This is a simple, basic blink for the Arduino. It writes high and writes low, and the pin 13 should blink. Right now on the board, it's very small, as you can see. It's a red LED that blinks intermittently, one every half second. As you can see, this solution currently works for Arduino Uno and for several boards, but also the script over here, we can connect a Raspberry to it and make it work even on a Raspberry, on a Udoneo, or on an Intel board. That's it. Thank you. Any more questions now? No? Thank you.